Hello, I'm Jacqueline Pollock, and today I'm going to talk about some tuning tips and tricks. Sometimes a student will come to me who's been playing the harp for a little while, and maybe overall tuning is going just fine, but they might have a few additional questions. Maybe there's a string that doesn't seem to want to stay in tune, no matter what they do, or maybe they're just wondering about the best conditions to keep their harp in. So today I'm going to go over some of these kind of smaller considerations, a few different scenarios and problems you might encounter, and talk about some tips to assist with tuning. We'll start by going over a few general considerations. One of the most obvious considerations to take into account is the environment in which you keep your harp. So you want your harp to be in a fairly consistent temperature and humidity at all times. When you're finding a spot for it in your house, usually I tell people to try to avoid somewhere with direct sunlight. You wouldn't want to put your harp right in the middle of a big window that's going to get lots of sunshine every day. And also to avoid heating and air conditioning vents or radiators, because that would fluctuate the temperature quite a bit. Harps are also really sensitive to humidity, so you might look into a dehumidifier or a humidifier, kind of depending on your climate and upon the season. Some people change these things out seasonally. Because the harp is made out of wood, it's very sensitive to humidity, so that can cause the wood to swell a little bit or shrink a little bit, which in turn, of course, affects the tuning. When you're moving your harp from one location to another, you always want to take the temperature outside into account. So if it's a really hot day or a really cold day, then you'd want to cool your car down or heat your car up for a few minutes before you put your harp inside. It's not a good idea to leave your harp in an unheated garage overnight, you know, if you were to just leave it in the car or something. Basically, you want to think of your harp kind of like a baby. So if it would be an uncomfortable situation for a baby where you would be worried about them being too hot or too cold, then the same would be true for your harp. And if you can keep your harp in a fairly stable environment as far as the temperature and the humidity goes, that goes a long way towards promoting tuning stability. Another big consideration is the strings themselves, specifically how old the strings are. As a professional harpist, I change my entire set of strings at least once a year, and some registers I change more frequently than that. I'd say most serious students change their set of strings maybe every 3 years. A lot of amateurs might go 5 years between restringing their harp. But regardless, the age of the strings is a big factor in how well you'll be able to get the harp in tune. So if you've only ever changed strings as they've broken, just kind of on a need to change basis, you might consider doing an all new set of strings. Or if you're looking to buy or have recently bought a used harp, that's always a good question, trying to find out how old the strings on the harp are and whether you want to go ahead and put a new set on right off. Just a couple of more general considerations before we get into some more specific situations. One is the position of your pedals and your levers when you start tuning. So if you play a pedal harp, all of your pedals should be in flat in the topmost position so that your strings are in the longest position when you tune. And similarly, if you play a lever harp, all of your levers should be disengaged, they should be down, before you begin tuning so that your strings again are in the longest position. If you're tuning with your pedals in natural or with some of your levers up, then usually you're just tuning a portion of the string rather than the entire length, and this will result in your harp not being as in tune as it could be. Sometimes when you're tuning, it can be difficult to make sure that your tuning key is attached to the correct peg on the back side of the harp. So if I'm tuning the entire harp, I usually tune my harps in the same manner. I begin with the middle C string, where it's very easy to see and get your tuning key on the correct peg to start off with. And then I tune all the strings from there on down. So all I have to do is just keep moving my tuning key to the next peg, and the next peg, and so forth. Then I come back to the D above middle C, attach my tuning key there, and tune all the strings from there on up. Again, just moving my tuning key by one peg all the way up to the top of the harp. If you just have one string that you need to tune, maybe it's a new string or just a string that's particularly out of tune, it can be a little bit difficult to find the peg. Some of them are really easy to see. These ones in the middle, you can just glance and see which peg goes with the string in question. But for some of the ones that are really high up or the really down low, it can be a lot harder to find the right peg. With the ones up here, I tend to put my thumb on the string in question and then swing my hand across to the peg on the other side, and then attach my tuning key by feel. And then when I start tuning, I always look to make sure, as I'm turning the tuning key, that the string that I think should be turning actually is, and I'm not on the neighboring string. For the really low ones, a lot of times I'll walk around to the back side of the harp, and especially if it's, you know, one of these very bottom strings, if you know it's the sixth string up, this A, you can just count six pegs on the back side and then attach your tuning key to the proper peg that way.
One final possible solution, if you're having trouble getting your tuning key onto the correct tuning pin, is to color code the tuning pins themselves. So here we have the back view of a different harp, and you can see that the C and F tuning pins are color coded the same way that we do the strings. So the C tuning pins have a little red circle around them, and the F tuning pins have a blue circle. And these are just little plastic circles, kind of like a rubber band, that you can slide on around the tuning pin in question. And in this way, when you look at the back of your harp, instead of just seeing a whole sea of silver tuning pins, instead everything is color-coded, and you can use that to find whatever tuning pin you need. One other way I've seen people do this, kind of create the same effect, is to use red and black electrical tape and just wrap a thin piece of tape around the tuning pins for the Fs and Cs to mark them that way.
Now that we've gone over some general considerations to take into account kind of with tuning right from the start, let's talk about some more specific problems that might be coming up. A big area for these are electronic tuners. Now, generally speaking, electronic tuners are great and they make the tuning process a lot easier, but sometimes they have their own issues that pop up from time to time. One question that comes up quite frequently with electronic tuners is about the electronic tuner displaying an incorrect name. For example, let's say that you played this B-flat string and your tuner didn't call it a B-flat. Now, if your string is just a little bit out of tune, it will probably call it by a name of the strings around it. It might call it an A or a C, which just means that your string is quite a bit flat or quite a bit sharp and you need to adjust it accordingly. But sometimes tuners do something a little bit more strange. Maybe you play this B flat, and instead your tuner calls it an E flat, which is nowhere close. And if you play a scale, you can check and generally see that your string is mostly in tune, just listening to make sure that all the strings are following sequentially. So if you're fairly certain that your string is close to being in tune as a B flat, that's not as far off as an E flat, but your tuner is still calling it an E flat, then what's happening is that your tuner is just getting confused. The reason that electronic tuners sometimes get confused by this relates to a topic called the overtone series. And if you have a lot of time on your hands, you can look this up and spend a lot of time learning about it. But the shorter explanation is that there are some similarities to certain pitches in music, pitches that are a fifth apart. This is kind of like a color wheel, you know, so on a color wheel there's opposites. Red and green are opposite, blue and orange are opposite, yellow and purple are opposite. And even though they don't look alike to, if you just see them kind of out in the world, you don't think of red and green as being similar, there are similarities to them. And the same is true of pitches that are a fifth apart in music. So E and B are five strings apart, and so there's a lot of similarities there, and sometimes tuners are led astray by this, and they call it by the wrong name. So if you're having this issue with your tuner, which pops up from time to time, it's really no big deal. You can just sort of ignore it, pretend that the tuner is saying B flat rather than E flat, and focus on making your small tuning adjustments, getting your needle right in the center with the colors lined up, however your tuner works, and then just continue tuning on from there. Another frequent problem with electronic tuners is that they're made to pick up any vibrating sound where they are. So if you normally use your tuner at home in the peace and quiet, then it's no problem. It works out quite well. But frequently when students start taking their harps places, and maybe they're trying to tune before an orchestra rehearsal, which can be really noisy because you have other instruments warming up, you have people talking and walking around and people setting up chairs, they find that their tuner just sort of is going haywire because it's picking up all of these sounds simultaneously and they can't really use it to tune their harp. Luckily, there's a great solution for this. This is what's called a tuning pickup, and these are really useful. So all electronic tuners, if it's a physical electronic tuner and not an app, has an input port like this. So you can just take your tuning pickup and plug it in. And then in this instance, the other side has a little attachment that you can just clip onto your harp anywhere. it doesn't really matter where you clip it. All it's doing is picking up vibrations. So you could clip it on any string and then leave it there the whole time you're tuning. You could clip it on around the back like this. I have another one here. This one still plugs into the input just the same way. The clip is a little bit bigger, so in addition to clipping it onto any string, you could also clip it onto the wood, kind of in the back of the harp there, like that. So these are really useful. They're not incredibly common. Sometimes you can get them at local music stores. You can certainly get them on Amazon. But if you're tuning in any sort of noisy situation, I find this helps a lot. Now that we've gone over some common issues with electronic tuners, let's talk about what might be happening if you just have one string that you can't seem to get in tune. This is pretty common. People will come and they'll say, overall my harp is staying in tune fairly well, but I have one string that doesn't seem to want to stay in tune no matter what. There are several different reasons that might contribute to this. So if somebody has a string or maybe a few strings that just don't want to stay in tune, the first thing I usually check is the tuning peg itself. The tuning peg is this metal piece where the string wraps around the one side, and then the back side, that's where you attach your tuning key to turn the string. And tuning pegs are shaped like a cylinder, but they're not even all the way across the way a pencil would be. They're more shaped like a carrot, where one side is a little bit thinner and one side is a little bit thicker. The thinner side is the side over here that the string wraps around, and the thicker side is in the back where the tuning key attaches. The reason for this is to make sure that the tuning peg can fit really snugly in the hole that's drilled in the middle of the harp. But sometimes over time they'll kind of work their way loose a little bit. They'll push a little bit that way, and so then the part that's in the hole in the middle of the harp is a little bit too thin for it, so they're kind of rattling around in there, and it's very hard to get your string in tune in that instance because it's not holding it securely. So you might get it all the way tuned up, but then the tuning peg is too loose to keep it right where you put it. If this is the issue, the thing to do is to take your tuning key, attach it to the string in question, and then while you're tuning it, kind of push the whole tuning key this way so that the peg slides back in more towards yourself. So usually I keep one hand here to get a really good grip on the harp, and then I push with the other hand while I'm tuning, and that will shift the tuning peg over just enough to get it right where you want it so that it's gripping well. Sometimes the problem might be with the string itself. Earlier we talked about how if you have a really old strings in your harp, you might just need an entire new set for tuning purposes. But you might have quite new strings and there might be one that's a little bit off. Sometimes the string itself is just what we call false, which means it's not quite at the quality that it should be. Especially if you have gut strings, and these are all gut strings in the middle of this harp, there can be little tiny variations within the string and the material that's used, and it might never come up to the level that it should be in terms of being really, truly in tune. Usually, you know this is the case where if over several days you just keep tuning the string and it never quite sounds right, your tuner might flop around. Sometimes it'll say it's flat and then you turn it the tiniest bit and then it goes all the way up to sharp and it just keeps going back and forth and back and forth and you can never get it quite in the center. Or sometimes the tuner will say it's in tune, but it just consistently sounds not quite right. A good way to check this is to play a harmonic an octave lower. So let's say that you're concerned about this string here. You could play the harmonic down here and compare the sound of the two. A lot of times if it's a false string, no matter how you tune it, when you compare it to the harmonic, it never quite matches. It never seems like it's quite as pure as it should be. If you decide that the problem is that this string is false, there's nothing you can do about it. You just have to take the string off and put a new string on. One thing to keep in mind if you're doing that is that especially with these higher strings up here, when you buy a new string, the string that comes is long enough, it's a long enough piece to use several times. You can get several strings out of the same package. So I have here, this would be a new string for this second octave G, and you can see how long it is. So if I were to put one on, there would still be enough left over that I could get another couple of strings. But if your string is false and you're putting a new string on and it's from the same piece, this whole entire string might be false. So usually I try and make a mental note if that's the case, and sometimes I buy a complete new string even when I still have some left over from the original because I'm worried that the entire piece might be false. I think the most useful thing that you can do in tuning is to just try and use your ears well. Even if you're tuning with an electronic tuner, it's always a good idea to be listening to what you're doing. And maybe you have a string that seems a little bit strange, but you've determined that the tuning peg is fine and that the string itself is not false. So then it's a good idea to just have a few different ways that you can listen to it and see if you can make adjustments that way. There's a lot of different ways that you could try and listen to strings and see what's going on. A couple of these we talked a little bit about earlier. One is to just play a scale. That can be a great way to get a general idea of whether things are sort of where they should be. It's especially useful if you're having trouble tuning the really low strings or the really high strings. Also, I use this next one, especially if I have a new string. If you just play an octave, so maybe you're tuning this string and then you're using this as a reference point to see whether or not it's in tune. A lot of times people play a fourth or a fifth in the middle when they're doing that. That can be a pretty nice way to hear what's going on. Also, we talked about this one just a little bit ago, playing a harmonic, an octave lower, and then comparing the two pitches because they're exactly the same in that instance, just a slightly different color. So that's a really easy one to hear. Also, you can use an enharmonic rather than a harmonic. An enharmonic is where you have two strings that are different but sound the same. So maybe you're tuning this G flat here. You could put your F pedal into sharp, and then an F sharp and a G flat should sound the same. That can be a great way to kind of check and see what's going on with your string as well. So always just trying to listen while you're tuning is sort of the moral of the story with all of those. I hope you found these various sort of little tips useful to you, and maybe a couple of them apply to what might be going on with your harp. Good luck to you in your tuning.